Hi, this is Gary with MacMost.com. On this episode, let's take a look at 10 new security features in macOS Catalina. MacMost is brought to you thanks to a great group of supporters. Go to MacMost.com/Patreon. There you could read more about it, join us, and get exclusive content. So a lot of what you get with macOS Catalina involves security, and a lot of it is completely invisible to typical Mac users. So the first one is Activation Lock. Activation Lock involves a piece of hardware that's on some of the latest Macs, particularly the MacBooks, also the latest Mac Mini and the iMac Pro, and soon it will be on all Macs. Now you can already use Find My Mac or the Find My app in Catalina to erase the drive on a lost Mac or locate it. But if somebody steals your Mac and it's running Catalina and has the T2 chip in it, they won't actually be able to erase the Mac and reuse it without your permission. It'll require authentication through your Apple ID. So it makes stealing a Mac kind of useless, as they can't do anything except maybe strip it for parts. This sort of security has already been available for a little while on iPhones and iPads, so it's great to see it come to Mac. Now in macOS Mojave, an app already had to ask you permission if it wanted to use the camera or the microphone. But now it's got to ask permission for a lot of different things. In particular, it needs to ask permission if it's going to access files. If it wants to access files in your Documents folder, it's going to ask you. If it wants to access files in iCloud, it's going to ask you, and a whole bunch of other different locations. It also needs to ask permission for all sorts of things, like access to calendar, contacts, etc. So the first time you run an app, it's going to ask permission, you grant it, and then you're set. But you can always go back and control these permissions in System Preferences. Just go to Security and Privacy, and you'll see a list of different things under Privacy, like the locations of files and calendar contacts, even screen recording and keyboard recording. And you can revoke access to any app, or if you accidentally didn't give access to an app where it's important, you can give it access here. Also, if an app wants to set something to run periodically on your Mac, it's called the cron tab, it's got to ask permission for that too. This is critical because it's one of the primary ways that something like adware or malware will mess with your Mac. Now there's an extra layer of security to prevent that. Now there's also a new feature in Safari that gives you a prompt the first time you try to download something from a website. It asks if you really want to download a file from this site. So that's one of the permissions now stored in Safari Preferences. So you can go and revoke or grant that permission to a website later on. So a useful feature for Apple Watch users is the ability to approve things using your Apple Watch. So you have your Apple Watch set up with the same Apple ID as your Mac, and then you get a prompt for permission, but now you can just tap your Apple Watch to grant permission instead of using your password. This is great for security because the less you actually have to use your password for minor things, the more likely people are to use a nice, long, secure, strong password. So a huge change that you may not even notice is that your Mac hard drive is now divided into two volumes. One is the system volume and the other is everything else, all your data and files and apps and everything. The system volume is going to be read-only, so files can't be modified or added to this volume. So the system is basically locked down. The only thing that can change it are signed updates from Apple. This will prevent malware from actually getting into your system and making any changes, and is a huge security improvement. If you look in Disk Utility, you can actually see these two separate volumes. But everything else appears normal. You still see the system folder in the Finder if you look at the main computer level, and it really doesn't affect typical Mac users at all, except it'll make things a lot more secure. Another change is that something called kernel extensions are being deprecated. So that means even though developers could still use system kernel extensions in macOS Catalina, they're a little bit harder to install. And the developers should be moving to using the new type of system extensions, which aren't part of the system, but part of the app itself. Now something that is gone in Catalina is the ability for Safari to run older Safari extensions. It used to be that you could install Safari extensions pretty easily from different websites, and apps could throw them in there too. And this was a security problem. Matter of fact, a lot of adware used extensions in Safari. They would add these extensions and then you'd get ads all over the place. Now for a while Apple has said they're getting rid of these and have allowed developers to have extensions as part of the Mac App Store. This means that those extensions are vetted and more secure. So it does mean that if you have an older extension, it's going to stop working in Catalina. Matter of fact, it'll stop working in the most recent version of Safari for Mojave as well. It's up to the developer to provide a Mac App Store version of that extension. Now, Gatekeeper has been a feature of macOS for a while, and you can set it to only allow apps installed from the Mac App Store or apps installed from the Mac App Store and signed apps from legitimate developers. And Gatekeeper also took a look at these apps when you first ran them to make sure there's no malicious code. But now Gatekeeper is actually going to keep looking at apps periodically as you run them over time. So if somehow an app has updated itself and now is malicious, it will then be caught by Gatekeeper. Apple is also enforcing a security procedure called notarization, which is when a developer creates an app and prepares it for distribution, they have to use an Apple tool to basically check it for malicious code. Notarization is now required for apps to run in Catalina. So you know every app has gone through at least one filter before it gets to you. Now for developers and advanced users, there's still ways to get around this and install basically anything you want on your Mac. But they're pretty hard to get to for typical Mac users, so they will make most Macs much safer. And one big new feature you've probably heard about is something called Sign In with Apple. So this is Apple's answer to the Sign In with Facebook or Sign In with Google features of websites and apps, where instead of having to create a new user account, you can use the user account for one of those services. But Apple's takes things a few steps further because Apple doesn't pass along any private information to the developer of the site or the app. And it also allows you to make your email address anonymous. So it could provide an email address that basically just forged to your real one so the website or app doesn't actually have your real email address. And while this is kind of a new feature of macOS Catalina, it should work also with previous versions of macOS as it's rolled out. Apple is actually going to insist that it's used in apps in the iOS and Mac app stores if the app is using these things at all. So if it's using Sign In with Facebook or Sign In with Google, it's got to also use Sign In with Apple. I'll be taking a closer look at Sign In with Apple in a future video. So for all of us that are interested in security, not just for us, but for all Mac users, Catalina is a huge step forward with these new features. I publish new tutorials every weekday. Hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out. Then hit the little bell icon to get notifications for each new tutorial.